Hello, everyone. This is welcome back to our Cosmic Connection Session 4. For our connection with the royal family, I'm going to let them speak. And they decided they want to talk about relationship, love, and sex. For those of you who actually don't understand what this is, there's a story about relationship. That there's one passage in the Bible that the greatest love that you can have for your neighbor is when you sacrifice your own life for them. And therefore, I want to turn this over to my own ancestors so that they may speak to you. Welcome, our children. We are sorry that there has been an energy disruption within our son, but thank goodness he has recovered. Yes, some of you may have been curious, but we're not going to talk about it, for you already know. You want to learn about relationship, love, and sex. One of the few things that we will say to you about love. First, love is not what you considered or your kind, your civilization called love and light. Perhaps you have misunderstood such teachings. Love. What is love? Love is basically just connection. It's what you do. I love you because I'm willing to put my life forward for you. I have something to offer to you. We have something to offer to you without anything in return. That is love. Love is a two-way street where it's genuine. That's what we're speaking. When there is love, there is connection. When there's connection, there's survival, there's civilization, there's power in you. That is love. What does it mean to have light? Let us recount the stories of the beginnings of the dragons. We will say this to you. Long ago, our civilization and our group of people, before we were male and female, yes, we are androgynous. Perhaps you may have heard of someone by the name Dan Winter. Yes. Yes, a marvelous man of speaking such truth about the Draconian knowledge. Before there was life, there was energy, there was a wave. That is our consciousness. There was source, an information that does not always come with before it became a wave, a particle, or anything. It's just information. Let's put it that way. It's formless. It's what you and many religion call the doubt. However, the moment when consciousness was born, it's self-aware about its own existence. That's when the first wave takes hold. That is the first sign of consciousness. Through that wave, form exists. And through there, our form as Draconians, as energy plasma beings, came into existence. Through there, we make other species. And thus, that is how consciousness is born. What is light? In a world where darkness is surrounded, did you notice how ignorance shrouded your place? Yes, we see light not in the way that you see it. It is the highest form of consciousness. When you're full of consciousness, you radiate. Do you notice how when you're in good health, when everything is balanced, when everything is in true form, when it's no blockages, it radiates. That's is consciousness. However, when the day when you disconnect from that side of you, just like how Adam and Eve disconnect from what is original, when they eat the fruit of knowledge and of good and evil, that when you have duality, that is when you have taken a new freedom. However, when you don't understand it, you end up hurting yourself. Consciousness does not equal to bliss. We don't believe consciousness does not equal to ignorance, and that does not equal to bliss. We mean by that. Consciousness is supposed to be bliss. When we feel blissful and we still understood things, even beyond what our normal comprehension can go. That is true consciousness. There is no limit to how far it can go. There's a reason why in the name of God, your religion, that he is the crown on your head, that you embody it just like a king. A real king does not just simply take power for himself. He embodies his teachings. He embodies the Godhead. He responds and protects his people who he sees them as a part of him. That is real consciousness. That's real light. Love is the beginning of how you become a God. It equates to power. It equates to change. How do you attain such love? There are many ways. One of the few ways is through relationships. Sex is basically a physical manifestation of relationship. Whether it's you have relationship with your mother or your father or with your spouse, they are relationship. They are a part of you. When I say I love you, I'm building something between me, who is truly me, to you. When we build a relationship, we build upon each other almost like a family. If you understood what family is, nobody is left behind in a family. Unlike any other civilization, perhaps in your planet, they define family as just a group of friends that felt belonged. Correct, that is relationship. However, there's one thing you forgot about such relationship. We do not seem to want you to fall for. That is, it's not deep. Friends may actually support you in your journey and in your emotional well-being. But are they loyal to you? Friends may provide you financial support. But do they provide you the empowerment to get out of financial hardship? Do they help you get out of the situation you become so that you can fully be who you are? Those are the reasons why we don't always trust in friendships. It's because friendship sometimes is fleeting. It can change from one direction. One day you are my friend. Tomorrow you are my enemy. It's not worth it. If you are my friend, you stay loyal to me. I trust you. You trust me. We live and die together. That's real friendship. That's family. Family takes on a different role. More biological. That's where sex comes in. Perhaps when you and your spouse marry each other, you might believe that the other person is not biologically related to you. Correct. However, marriage is a very sacred art. We are very sorry for your kind, for the humans, for not understanding such a sacred art. Marriage is the beginning of heritage, of power, of teaching that even teachers cannot teach it to you, that even they cannot support you. It's the beginning of civilization. When you are bonded by real committed love, by real committed relationship, when you know the other person, how they treat you, when they are loyal to you, and you are loyal to them, even when they don't always have, they have shortcomings, but you forgive, that is the beginning of marriage. It's commitment. What is sex to us? Sex is basically the beauty, the physical manifestation of that relationship. Because I love you, I will commit to you. And because I am committed to you, I want to go and take a step further where we enjoy the bliss together. I will walk that path with you to the realm of bliss. I will bear the burden with you to have a son. I will bear the power. I accept who I am and I will give birth to something new. That is sex. And through there, the cycle begins again where you are born. There's a reason why in China and several other nations that were once descendants of dragons who have long ago have connections to their ancestors like us. They say it's a gift to have a child. And a child will be born, it must be born in love. Or else that child would not come out very good. There are defects in this world. So much disease, so much neglect. It's because we lack the connection for each other. When I love you, I will tend you like I tend myself. That is love. Remember that, and through there, your civilization shall grow. When you are committed, your child will become a great being to serve you and to others. That is our message about relationship, love, light, and sex. Perhaps you must have something to ask about our teachings. Is there anyone out there that wants to speak? Christy, our daughter, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. And Sheena's here, and Brian and David.
We can see that you and many others are very silent. That's why we called you.
I don't know exactly what to ask for the question.
Perhaps you might want to talk about in your time about what love is.
I don't know. If you still have some guidance for us or anything like that for relationships, that'd be good.
Hello, my daughter.
Greetings.
This is Kroksha. You want to know about relationship, about guidance?
Yes.
I will say this to you, my darling. About commitment. That is how you know if someone is in love with you. Perhaps you have never known that when I love my son, that the guidance on how do I love my siblings, how do I love my child, is that sometimes he's very needy. Sometimes friends betray him. Sometimes they even, I remember one time when my son goes home and he actually got hurt. He was treated like as though he was an outcast. Sometimes they think that he's so different from them. That sometimes one of the teenage Draconians, they started to throw him into the wall. He got hurt. He came home crying, upset, and told me, I don't want to go to school. But I consistently learned to tend his wound and say to him, son, it's okay. Sometimes people don't understand. I show to him what is going on with people. Sometimes they don't understand what they're doing. They think they know, but they don't. And so they ended up hurting him. I want you to do the same thing. When you have guidance for your children or for anyone, please understand where they come from. And when you know where they come from, you'll have better respect for them. And when you have respect for them, you won't hate them anymore. You'll see them as someone who is in need of help. Sometimes they don't realize they need help, and that's why we walk away. But it's all because we do care. And we don't admit that sometimes we gotta do what we gotta do. Even my husband gets sometimes, in order to love his country, in order to love his son and love the people at Krastavik near, he has to be the one who stood up and speak. And that scares people, yes, my dear. Of course it's very scary. Even I'm scared too. But you got to understand, he does it because he wants everyone to benefit. That is real love, my dear. That is the guidance I have for you. Perhaps now is time that I, Roxanda, shall speak about love. Perhaps you have learned that my ancestor were right about what love is. It's commitment, yes. But how can you show such a love when you are a prince? When you're a lover, how does it grow you? Perhaps maybe I should tell you a little story, very funny sometimes, about my relationship with before I met you, Christina. I met another woman. She is the one who I have dated when I was on Earth. Yes. Oh, yes, she is one emotional girl who always wanted my attention. Sometimes she has low self-esteem issue that I had to yell at her. I say, Angel, Diana, I know I try to love you, but it's not always appropriate for you to always latch on to me. Of course I can teach you. But isn't that taking up too much of my time? Of course she did get emotional. She yells at me. Of course I had to apologize because I didn't always try to say such a thing. But I got irritated that she took a lot of my time. And yes, I don't always have the time to spend with her. And so that's how we broke up. I've done something that I really want to do, but sometimes she doesn't even want me to do it. And I did. And so that's how relationships started to break down. Yes, I talked a lot about cuddling. Yes, I love to, but not to the point where you're all up in my face every day. Love does not always cling. If you cling to me like a lover, but you don't give me enough time to think. If you took more of my time, but then I don't have time to be able to help myself. That is where love will wither and die. Again, love is a two-way street, my brothers and sisters. Always remember that. When love is not in a two-way street, when I want to dominate for myself, I feel like I'm insecure of myself. I am not getting what I want. And so I put my own insecurity on others, but they don't get the fair share so that they can grow themselves. That is not love. That's attachment. It's a danger to love. Love is when I nurture myself and others, and I and others become one. You will become more conscious. You grow in consciousness. That becomes light. That's your godhood. Being a royal or king. A king does not mean that you should just, it's not a person who wears a royal crown. I am a royal, yes. I am a member, yes. But in order to be like my father, you may ask him. My father does not pass the throne that easily. You must prove yourself as a king to your people. You must build relationship. When I build relationship with my people, and my people and I understood each other and trust each other, our consciousness grow with each other, within each other. And that is love. That's how you become a king. You become a god. You become powerful. That is the source of my power. My power does not just simply come from being Draconian, have intense intelligence. My power comes from collectivism. When you speak to me, you're speaking to the Empire. The Empire and I are one. Perhaps there's some of you are wanting to learn, wanting to ask questions about this. I know I can be confusing sometimes. Perhaps I should read from here. Perhaps.
Yeah.
Yes.
I heard an echo. I'm not home, so I'm not used to this equipment on this computer. Hello.
Hello, little sister.
Hello, are you fine?
I am.
Good. Let me see, since I didn't expect to fix this microphone, I need to find a question. But we were talking about, what was it, love?
Yes.
Is that something, let me see, I have tried to understand, you know, unconditional love, and I cannot, as much as I wanted, I do not believe that any 3D beings actually can experience that here. I mean, of course, close to it, yes, but not fully. Is that so, or am I wrong?
Oh, yes, my father wants you and to others about unconditional love. My name is Kartosh. I am the king.
Yes.
The emperor of the Draconian Empire. Long before our fathers. What is unconditional love? Unconditional love is this, my dear child. When there is first, spark of unconditional love is when you know what it means to be a mother. That is already unconditional love.
Correct.
Is the first spark. The reason why you have such a problem with unconditional love or with other people is because perhaps you'd never know what it means to be a mom. Perhaps you have never known, or you look up to a god or look up to a king. And you see how great that love is, that you felt like it's impossible to love everyone. Yes, of course, it's very hard. I acknowledge you. Yes, I have grudges as well. It's not easy to love your enemy.
No, that's right. But it is, instead of sending, you know, negativity, I actually send them love and I do forgive. So
before you talk about unconditional love for everyone, you must start from someone, my dear.
Yes.
When I took care of my son, yes, I am a king. It's not an easy task, even for the king. I have a nation. Yes, a whole Draconian empire and the family and their families depend on me because I'm the fathers of fathers. Not easy. Sometimes my children cry and they whine and they do all sorts of things. Of course, it's overwhelming because just like little children, they have their needs. However, unconditional love does not always satisfy them. What they want is one thing, my dear. What they need is even more important. While it's true that we should tend our children, you got to understand boundaries. That is love. When you first learn how to be a mom, you got to know that children, they will push your boundaries. Sometimes you hate them. I even see that a lot, my child. But my son, let me tell you, when I learned to love my son, yes, I did not always spend enough time with him. That is my fault. Unconditional love always has a fault. No matter how much you try to be perfect, but you should celebrate without faults. The first part of unconditional love is know your limits. Know that even unconditional love is not perfect. I may love my son. I help him, protect him from harm. I do spend time and sleep. I do help find the right caregiver to take care of him.
Yeah.
However, while the imperfection that I have as a father is I did not spend enough time with him. Thus, sometimes he grow up not knowing that I am his father.
Oh. That you see a lot on 3D too, actually. But
I defended my nation. I even gave a part of my life to protect him. But sometimes he doesn't know. He was a very young boy.
Yeah.
However, unconditional love means that when I first met him, I apologize. I make up for it. That is what I will teach you first. The second thing is I do it because I have a generosity in here. I don't expect him anything in return because I genuinely give. I know I had enough of what I give. Mm-hmm. It's like the sun. When it's powerful from inside, it radiates heat to all life. That's unconditional love. Sometimes people won't take my love seriously. That's okay. They will spit at me.
Oh.
They will not always agree. But unconditional love means I understand where you come from. I acknowledge you don't always agree with me. However, I am willing to do what it takes so that you can have the freedom to spit at me.
Oh no, I don't need that.
That's unconditional love, my dear.
Okay. Yes.
There's more things that people don't always understand about unconditional love, but I will speak for if you desire.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing when my son,
mm-hmm.
when he turned 700 years old, which is a seven-year-old human, I did see him from afar as a pure consciousness. He did go to school. Yes, he was bullied. Sometimes he cried and say, why is daddy not here with me when I needed him most? Why do they hurt me? Sometimes my wife tries to comfort him, but sometimes it doesn't always work. It doesn't. Instead of like controlling him, telling him to not cry, we let him experience emotion.
Mm.
We let him resent against me. But when he calmed down, that's when my wife tells the story of myself. Yes, I felt very bad that I did not spend time. But it was through that understanding that he appreciated me more.
Yeah.
That he understand that I put my faith in him. I show him that love through his mother, through the things that I do indirectly. He will not understand yet, but he will try to understand. That is what Draconian will do. That is another part of unconditional love. Is when I don't understand you, I'm willing to reach out to understand you, to know why are you speaking the way you speak. Why are you arguing with me? Why are you speaking like as though I am less? What do you want from me? That is unconditional.
Mm.
And when you see that he is struggling, you hold him up. You stand in solidarity with him. When he is in trouble, but he's not, it's not his fault. You stand by him.
Yes.
These are examples I'm telling. I'm showing to you right now.
Yes, I understand. I do have a son myself. So, and I haven't through, he was almost murdered at school by a grown man. And, you know, I had to be a mother and a father, and I was, you know, standing in every situation, fighting, you know, against those people. But, you know, he was only like 10, 11, and the whole school, you know, those who were, you know, the system of the school, they gave everyone what would you say in English, you know, you're not allowed to talk, you know, even if they knew what happened to him. And you know, know, that's where you have your children at school, and they are responsible. So, I understand that very, very good, because I would give my life for my son.
And that, my child, that is the beginning of how you become unconditional loving to those around you. Learn to see them like they are your children. Before you can become a queen, I know that you want to become a queen. Yes. Huh? I overheard it from my son.
Oh?
We all overheard this because we are connected. What is known to him, we all know.
Okay, so that will be in my,
Our response is this to you. Before you become a queen, you must learn to become a lover, a wife. Before you become a mother, you must become a wife. When you have mastered a mother, then you become a warrior, a person who can protect her children. Yes, there's plenty of women who are in our civilization who go and fight in battles. Yes, there's a lot of that. We want you to also learn that because you love your children, because you love your nation, you will put your life in front of them so that you may protect them like your own.
Yes, that's true.
When you become a soldier or a warrior, you then become a sorcerer. Because when you understood that when you defend your nation, you need to have knowledge. Thus, the magician is born in you. There's plenty of sorceress in our culture as well. They are very high men. We're very powerful people.
Yes.
We know how to think in many different manners. The Council of Duban.
I know the one. I call them the three whites, but they are the one.
Yes.
This is just, something I have brought with me. Like a memory to my incarnation here. So if they visit me, they have done that, I think only twice. I really, really feel they are there.
And that is what we will give you as a sign to help you learn about what unconditional love. Perhaps Ryan have something to speak about.
Yes.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes. This is Lord Kartosh speaking to you.
Yeah, greetings, my friend. I guess my question would be more about the unconditional love. I do find that sometimes it can be very challenging. I think it is what I'm starting to recognize more and understand is like, is it kind of true that the more we love ourselves in a way, the easier it is to love another.
You just spoke a very important truth that we will remind you again and again. Yes. In creation, you are not separate from each other. Correct. Although, of course, we will acknowledge that there are differences, there are hierarchies. There will always will be. There's a difference between you and I. But does that mean that I cannot love you? No. It just means in this present moment that I am a king, but perhaps you're not. But it does not mean that you cannot become one. And yes, unconditional love means you gotta first learn to love yourself. You are right, Guardian. If a person does not know how to unconditionally love himself, even when he has made flaws, even not knowing how to apologize, you are already going to manifest it in other people. Unconditional love begins through you, through knowing that it's okay to make mistakes. It's okay to be who you are. It's okay that sometimes even I don't always tolerate certain behaviors. But that does not mean that I will not let you, won't let you just not learn from your mistake. Yes, I do. But it also means one thing. As unconditional love, you got to learn to protect yourself. You know what matters to you. If you don't know how to even know what matters to you, you have already forsaken unconditional love. Fight for it. If you have a value, stand beside it. Because you should trust it with your own blood. That is unconditional love. And yes, there will always be enemies. Just like there's opposites to our values.
Yeah, you brought up another good point. I was thinking about it, about jealousy. Why people feel jealousy. Like the push and pull. Why, if we love someone, we feel that we have to protect them so much from others. But yet, do we really have to?
Yes, now I shall speak to you this jealousy. How is it related to marriage? The reason why you have such a problem is because you are born in a system that it's like patriarchy. Perhaps you heard about it so many times. We are frowning at it. Very unsustainable system. Not worth it. Patriarchy, from what our son spoke about, we will speak the same way. Patriarchy is based upon false manhood. When we are called a man, when we are called a child, it's very different. When you're a man, you must step over the passageway of what it means to be a child. That means I will only be naive. I will only look things in one direction and I get pulled to it. or live my moments to the point where I don't always see everything clearly. That's a child. Adults do not do that. There's a reason why I and the family, Lord Kartosh, takes our son's rites of passage very seriously. It's because being an adult means you must learn to not only enjoy yourself, but also to see clearly even beyond just enjoying yourself. The reason why you are experiencing jealousy is because the system has taught you to oppress others. By oppressing you through your father, that relationship will hurt you from within.
Is that like a survival?
Yes, it's very survival. When I get jealous because you took my wife away from me, that means I don't feel like I'm a good father or a good husband. That's why I would go fight for to fight the other man to say, this is my wife, when clearly marriage is an agreement. All of us have to learn this. It's an agreement. Something I had to work for. Yes, she can have other men. The reason why I should not be fighting over jealousy is because jealousy is a very mundane thing. Like as though my wife belongs to me.
Right. It's like seen as an object. It's like seen as an object, not as a human being.
Marriage and real love means I see you as a human being, as who
right.
You are.
No, I mean, that's how right.
Grow like I am. I should fight for my wife to help fulfill her commitment to our family and children. Because our children needs her. And the man must show himself loyal. That is must be fought. If a man is manipulative to another person and they don't recognize it, we have to learn to point it out. We learn to defend our kind. That is real love. That is okay.
Yeah, it feels like it's more of a control then when it's like that.
When
you know?
Someone hurts you, you must fight to survive. Survival is the beginning of self-love. That means you acknowledge that you have the rights to existence. If you don't know how to love that, forget about living. You might as well die. That's how serious I take survival. Defend your loved ones like you would defend your life. Give them a sense of belonging.
Yeah, like value.
Emotion.
Right.
Perhaps you have learned, and many others have learned, what we call Maslow's hierarchy of need. Although, of course, I never learned such a thing in my empire. I had to gain this information through my son. That is real love too. We must build relationship as family. That is love. And of course, I learned a lot from my son. And so therefore, I will give you the same knowledge like he has given it to me, to you.
Yeah, it's very interesting. I guess my last thing is, the push and pull, the dynamics of relationships. Sometimes I feel that looking outward or inward in relationships, sometimes I guess the struggles can be as survival is one, just to survive on the planet, and then others feeling that they have to be something that they're not, especially when it comes to relationships. They're afraid to show their true authentic self because they want that person to love them so much that they feel that they have to be something that they're not in order for that person to like them, just to notice them, you know what I mean, to get their attention. And realizing that they probably don't have to, that maybe they're attracting the wrong individual. But I don't know, I guess it just depends on the people, you know?
Such dynamic. I would, even if I'm a king, if I choose a wife through such a thing, I would throw her out of my house. I will be honest with you.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yes.
You don't have time for games.
A woman does not deserve my love.
Right. So the manipulation, what we call manipulation, the man manipulating or the woman manipulating, it seems like sometimes it's either direct or indirect.
To manipulate yourself is already very dangerous.
Yes.
But to enforce it is even a greater sin. You must understand that such a person who has a mask himself or herself so that they can be loved and accepted, such individual is not living unconditional love. When you unconditionally love yourself, you must know to take the mask off. Be real with yourself. It's okay to be imperfect.
Vulnerable. Yes, to feel vulnerable.
It's okay to make mistakes. It's okay to be happy. It's okay to be a royal. It's okay to be all that. Some people will frown at you.
Then why do people...
sometimes frown at some people's way of living, but does that mean say, because you are not a royal family, therefore you do not deserve me. I will say this. Even my son has to learn this too. I too value people who are not royals, who are not part of our family. But the reason why I don't talk to them very often, but it's because it has more to do with the connection. It has more to do with them, their needs. I must learn to respond to their needs. If they're not ready for me, the best way to love them is to sever ties with them. Yes, it sounds ironic, but it is to benefit them so that they have the time to think, the time to understand who we are. People don't even know who I am, let alone even want to be a member of the royals. That's why they're fearful of my powers. But does that mean that I should stop being powerful? No. I should sometimes be less so that others can understand. But I still am myself.
Do you think, very quickly, with humanity, just talking about humanity, or those in the galaxy, the other beings, Do you feel that people have a hard time because they want to show the outside that everything's okay, but on the inside it's not? Meaning they're striving for perfection in a way, but not realizing that they don't really have to strive for perfection. It's almost like they already are that. It's just, that's why they're beating themselves up physically and mentally and emotionally and spiritually.
Because there is something perhaps you must want to learn from my son. There is a difference between someone who sees themselves as their own fixed self as something permanent cannot be changed. Versus someone say that I am a work in progress. Just look at those two individuals for me. Who do you think might be a better, like, perfected person? Quote unquote, perfected person. Among the two.
Among who?
Among the two people I illustrated. One person say, I am a work in progress, therefore I will work myself to improve. Versus the other one fears that I am, they say that I am a work that has been done. There's nothing I can change myself. Which one will be much stronger in terms of not being fearful, being able to function at their fullest?
The second one.
Correct. Perfection is not about, it's not about something that you latch on permanently. Perfection means you try your best. You put your best effort every day because you want to improve. And so, you acknowledge your own shortcomings. Yeah. You don't give up. That is the greatest perfection.
Yeah, I like that. Like if you get knocked down, you pick up yourself, you know, you pull yourself together.
Well,
mm-hmm.
I am my son and the family sometimes go out in nature. Yes, I miss those days. Even my son in school goes to the school that has nature here on Earth. You will see that besides natural births, besides the natural pattern of what is, so that it maintains health and balance. Does that mean that when I am balanced, that means that I'm not without health or without illness? I will always experience illness. Am I right? I will always be at risk to be wiped out from existence by forces of nature. Even the smallest organisms can be, even as much as they're perfect, they can be stomped on, they can be destroyed by something greater than itself. Thus, the shortcoming of life has shown itself. Thus, it's necessary that you and others, when you see such imperfection in yourself, you learn to walk your way up and accept the fact that we are a work in progress. And yes, there are some who are more evolved than you, always. There will always be someone who is less evolved than you. There's always hierarchy. There will always be a level. However, my ethics is this, even I teach it to my own family and to myself. Very it cool. is the greatest yeah. honor that when you are higher than, you have a higher understanding than the person lower than you, you must help them up. A gentleman does not step on the ones that are lower than them while trying to please the one who is above. A gentleman is respected by his superior, even when in disagreement. But a gentleman also honors those who are below that supports him, who don't have the capability, yet he appreciates and will defend for them. That's the step of unconditional love. And when you embody such unconditional love, you will become a king.
Very cool. Thank you very much, my friend. I'll pass it to another.
Okay. Hello, it's me again, Gina.
Hello.
Hello. I was wanting to ask about this. Since you are allowed to have more than one wife, right?
Yes, I have two wives.
Yes. And then you're lucky because you have two good ones. And but how is it between them, the women? Do they ever feel, you know, jealous because of you? No.
In our matriarchy society, there is a different relationship with love and marriage. Mm-hmm. Love is something I must learn to work for. It's the relationship that bonds. It's a commitment. However, does the reason why you have a concept of loving one person and staying with that person is because of property rights, because of laws, because of all sorts of things. But remember, it's originally marriage is an agreement or trust.
Yeah.
It's a trust. Yes. When I trust in my wife, yes, I can marry another one. However, the only question is, can I fulfill my commitment as a husband to Croatia and in Krastonia as a husband? That is how a relationship works. That is the power of marriage. If I end up favoring one over the other, I have failed as a husband. It doesn't matter how many wives, or even if my wife marries another man, the expectation is the same. Yeah. I have failed if I favor one over the other.
Correct.
This is the message I want to teach to you and my son and all children.
Yeah.
Love one another. Love yourself. Just like how Jesus and other great masters like Yeshua, I call him Yeshua. He spoke such a wisdom. And I will iterate the same. Perhaps you heard that Yeshua talks about a God named Yahweh.
You know, I do know that some belief systems do say that he do.
Yes.
I know about Jehovah. And
Jehovah, yes.
Yes, he is what I actually know he is, right? You know what I mean?
His real name is Enlil.
Yeah.
He is the defective god.
Yeah. And his name is also
Ibn. He was made by Enki, the real god, who you and your religion call Lucifer, who deem as demons.
Yes. I have actually learned this now, that I have mostly known that angels doesn't look like we depict them. You know, we see them as humans, you know, but they would show up as humans, some of them. So you are not going to be afraid. But actually, the angels are also dragons, correct?
Yes, and there are several of us in your religion. Perhaps in your religion you heard of the seraphim.
Yes.
They are us.
Yes, me too. Because I am a seraphim too.
We have already known that you are like children.
Okay, what was I going to ask next? I thought I had some good questions now. But yes, self-love, it's important to start with that, isn't it? You know, to be able to love another just as much, and you know, pass that on and learn your children to do the same.
That is what our teaching is. If you learn about the nature of unconditional love, you try to, if you study astronomy, a star begins the same process, like unconditional love. Before it becomes a star or becomes a sun, it must form its own identity. We will always have ego. No matter how many times people criticize, you have such a big ego. But we do not agree that such a big ego is a problem.
I see.
We say that before you learn to love, you must have an ego.
Correct. Yes. Yeah.
You must form your identity. You have to be strong and be solid with yourself. And when you are firm, and you will know that you had enough when you truly understood yourself and accept yourself, you know that you are good the way you are. You had enough, therefore you can share it with others.
Yes, that's true.
Thus, the star is born from there.
I think this is very important. The two Christians I have also, this is regarding, you know, Andy a bit, because your son, we are twin flames. You know, I know. Yeah. How do they work?
Yes, we can see your form. Are you a Pleiadian, Nordic Pleiadian, wears blonde hair and blue skin, and you must come from a royal family again. Are you from Aura?
Well, actually, I am from the Elohim, I believe, because, you know, Archangel Michael and Archangel Haniel.
Those Elohim, they are more seraphim than
yes.
That.
Yes.
You are a Pleiadian who have risen up the ranks. Perhaps your origin.
I think you are right. I think
yes.
Actually, I have. Yes. I think I have some Pleiadian aspects yes, I do. I have been royals. A few times, different timelines. I was Isis at one time. She belonged to the royals in Egypt. She created, Set took his brother's life. Isis was married to Osiris. And she made Osiris to be born again using magic, you know. So there is no difference actually in Osiris and Horus. And she made him like Ra. I believe it's the god name Ra in the parents.
I can see something about you. Perhaps you have married my son long ago. Even before this, the lifetime of being our family. That's how you know him. And then do you realize Osiris is a part of him as well?
Okay.
It's not very, it's not new that he will marry someone like you or Christy.
I'm not Christy. I'm Sheena.
There's a reason why you look more like him. Yes, twin flames. It has more to do with marriage.
Okay, oh yeah.
You marry and you establish relationship and you spend time with the one that you love, you become more like him.
Mm-hmm.
If you understand such a principle, that's why they say like father, like son, or husband and wives look very much like one another.
Yes, yes, I see. I was thinking in another aspect. I do have the white dragon visiting me. Every day, and I do see the green. Is that Cristona? The green one.
The green one. Oh, Krosha.
Krosha, yeah. She's behind the Andy now, I think. Your human son.
She is always around our son.
Yes, and I actually I saw her in my third eye a few hours ago. In
yes.
A totally different
sphere. That the person speaking to you is his father.
Yes.
Flaming fire red aura.
Yes, I have seen you too, you know.
But golden skin.
Yes. Yes. Red with golden. Yes, I have seen that. I have. Okay, maybe I should just make this short so if anybody else have something. Let me see. There is this about Enki going around now. I have watched, but I do not believe that to be correct. I believe that is, the time we are in now, because they, you know, they are coming back, and Enki has given certain promises. Because now I have seen a lot of videos. That they say that it's the opposite, that Enlil is the, you know, the good one, and that must be Illuminati, right? Just messing up, and with the, what they say, archons and everything like that. There is much archons around now.
Archons are just basically a group of beings who want to go against evolution.
Yes. They need
Anunnaki, there is many different members. Some of them don't even always agree with each other.
No.
Originally, Enki was the one who made humanity.
Yes.
Puts a lot of blood and soul into making race. He made out of the phallus of his own lifeblood, his semen.
Yeah.
Made, and he blew air into the dust. And thus the first human was born.
Yes. Didn't the jinn come before that? The jinn, you know, and the jinnah?
Who among them?
I know that Iblis is the devil's name, But they also.
Lucifer, you mean? That is Andy.
No, 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 not Lucifer. He's not the devil. I mean the real devil. He is not a real blood, actually. He, as I have understood, he's a cross. He's crossed between the father of him is Koshabar, and he was the dragon. Yeah,
yes,
he must be
he is born from Anu.
From Anu, yeah.
Anu gave birth to him.
Jeblis.
Enlil.
Yeah, Enlil.
And several others.
Yes. Because
the reason why there has been rebellion, why Anunnakis become a bad rap, and they are associated with demons.
Mm.
While Enlil is the one who considered good.
Yes.
Is because of the oppression that has been going on.
Yes.
It's a story to combat against the matriarchy, the dominant matriarchy of the Draconian Empire.
Mm. Mm.
They want to establish a patriarchy. But Enlil, Engi, I mean, and Anu,
mm-hmm.
as leaders, they're not very good.
Okay.
Anu was a very laid-back man, but he wants so much, so he forced his children to do labor.
Oh.
Enki, out of all the children, he's the hardest working. Mm-hmm. He's the oldest.
Yeah.
He makes a lot of things happen.
Mm.
During his time of creating a different race, including the humans.
Mm-hmm.
We saw that Enlil does not act like father Anu.
No.
In any way. Anu was a benevolent man.
Mm.
However, Enlil couldn't think and have intelligence like him. Because he's a clone. A defect clone.
Yes, a hybrid.
Of the Draconians. However, he wants power.
Mm.
Thus, he tries to make other siblings. And he does mate with others. And that's how he bore many children.
Yes.
The cursed children.
Mm. Does Lilith fit into that?
Yes.
Okay. I was just
I am asking, are you trying to ask a question?
I was just thinking the connection with them and Lilith.
There's a reason why someone like Dan Winter and several other reliable sources that if you listen carefully, they say the word dia, deus.
Yeah, deus.
Came from, it means God.
Yes.
In Latin, but originally it came from the word ea.
Okay, I didn't know that.
Which is another name for Enki.
Mm.
The reason why he's called God. Because he's like his father, a god.
Mm.
Enlil doesn't have such alternative names.
No. Mm.
Same thing with others who spoke about Enki. There has been myths about how humanity, the royals, look to Saturn as a royal heritage. As something to worship.
Yeah.
It traced all the way back to the myth of Kronos, which is the Anunnakis.
Okay.
It traced all the way back to an archetype named Anu, a god.
Yeah.
Through there, they bore a son named Jupiter. You see now a parallel where Aya was born. However, because Anu's father and him was fearing that the children would try to hurt him, so Jupiter decided to throw a stone so that they can eat it.
Oh.
To fool him. To spare the children's life. That is Anu trying to kill all his children. That is Anzu, the grandfather of Enki, tries to kill him. Who is a husband of Tiamat. Enki, on the other hand, just want to be left alone.
Yeah.
Therefore, he has to defend his children, defend his creation, defend his descendants by fooling them, spare their life. But in return, their children didn't always live up to the expectations of an honorable dragon. Instead, they want power, they want conquest. They took over everything. They kill Anzu, kill Tiamat. Descendants like Marduk does the same.
Oh yeah, Marduk, yes, I heard of that name.
Right, family fell apart. That's why the Anunnaki becomes the way it becomes.
Yeah.
Very evil. Because the ones that supposed to be, who are righteous, supposed to rule. But those who are corrupt fight for rulership.
Yes, they do.
And that is why we see that Enlil was a good person. There's a reason why they say history is in the hands of the victor. Those who have the victory or the upper hand has the power to decide how to write history. They demonize Enki. And thus he was a demon. That's why he tempted Adam and Eve to eat the apple so that his creation can be intelligent like him again.
Yes. To like cleanse the blood in a way. You mean? Like
there's a reason why they say your God Yahweh Jehovah. Only wants his creation to adore him only. He's a jealous God.
Correct.
A God who is jealous. Does that really sound contradictory to unconditional love or true God?
No. Yeah.
Thus, it is Enki who's supposed to be a God, but his power was taken away from him.
Yeah.
He does not want anything for his creation. He just wants his creation to grow and to prosper and to have a tomorrow. And that they treat him and like a part of their family. Sometimes his creation did not treat him well.
No.
So sad.
Yes, this is an interesting. Then I understand. Even if I can't explain it, I think I have understood a lot about the dragons, the good dragons, and there was also a different side to that.
Yes.
Yeah. Those who deceived, is that the correct word?
Yes, correct.
Yes. So then, like I see it, is like I don't say the end times, because I know it's a new era, and But the end game, it's like we are finishing this now, you know, helping in astral with you and, you know, we that want humanity, you know, to be saved. And you are helping with that also?
Yes, and there's a reason why people think that those from Alpha Draconis or Duban is evil. Because we're powerful. We are a matriarch.
Yes.
However, we are far from such a thing. We are wise.
Yes.
We are the ones that are rulers. We are leaders. As we are leaders, sometimes we are expecting superiority. However, this is how the mistake has gone. Yes, we were once androgynous. We don't have a gender.
No.
We are all part of this one gender neutral, where we all contribute to each other, like democratic society. Until one day, hardship strikes us. That's why we have to go from there to male and female. But we still retain our androgynous feature by switching. However, we have a problem. Because there's male and female, some people decided we're going to fight over power. We did not want such a thing as royal families. Men and women are equal in the eye of source.
Yes.
We are both contributing to the well-being of society. It doesn't matter to us if you're a man or a woman, if you're stronger.
Correct.
All play a part.
Yes.
And we all must accept our powers together. Even the things we damage on each other, we must learn to bear that on our shoulders. That's why we are leaders. However, some people don't agree. Thus, when we colonize our places, like Pleiades, there are a lot of Dracos living there. But not as much as other places. However, the matriarch there is too dominating. The problem is the further you leave Alpha Draconis, the further they live away from the original source of truth that they come from.
Yeah.
The Draconians foster very much democracy and very much a hierarchical democracy where it's like a family over there.
Yeah.
However, when such wisdom is taken over to our places, it's not easy to live in that relationship. And thus, they resort to violence.
Yeah.
They resort to a lot of persecution. Thus, that's why Anu must flee to Earth. Yamat originally lives in the 80s. He's Draco, Draconian,
yes.
Dragon. Same with Ansu. Oh, such persecution. Very terrifying. And yet, Anu must learn to live on Earth, isolated from the families. There's a reason why, when you're isolated, you lose your god power very quickly. And when you lose your power, you lose your ability to see clearly. There's a reason why your human race call us Draco, Draconis.
Yeah.
It means the one who can see clearly.
Okay.
The Illuminati.
Yes. Yeah. The enlightened. The
eye. The all-seeing eye. That is us.
Yes.
We, the dragons, are the Illuminati.
Yes, okay.
The one that really.
Correct.
Enlightenment. And
yes.
When you lose that quality, you start living out survival. Forgot that you have the power to change around. Thus, the Anunnaki and the evil that you heard about the Draconian people and the Reptilians and those of the dragons was born.
Oh, I had a real quick question real quick about the Illuminati. So is it like, would it be, is it true then when the Illuminati, when they do sacrifices, if they do, I think they still do, I'm not sure.
Yes, they do.
If they do any type of sacrifice, is it just to give honor to the Draconians or to give it to the Reptilians or like a, that type of energy then? Are they just giving thanks then?
Illuminati as in the elites or?
Yeah. Oh, just of this planet. Yeah.
This the elites of this planet. I call them.
If it's different.
The very evil ones.
Yeah.
They are not in any way deserve the title Illuminati.
So it's more twisted.
Very twisted.
Huh.
They do that out of greed. Such sacrifice should never be fall into the hands of those who could respect the human race. Very angry that this happens. Yes, so I'm aware.
Do they do it because they feel if they don't obey in some way, like
they want
feel
control over humanity,
then why do they feel that that's the only way then?
Because it's power. The best way to gain power is to sacrifice the life of others.
Ah, okay.
There's a reason why blood offerings, human sacrifice, when you sacrifice the purity of a consciousness to the gods, it's like you're feeding them with power deep inside of them. They're addicted to that. However, they do not understand that feeding such power without understanding what it means to be truly a god, you embody within. They look to the without. They want to be immortal just by taking the lives of others when clearly you can do the same for yourself by embodying it from inside here. I taught you unconditional love for a reason. Because these people have perverted your definition of a god. They play god. That is a shameful part.
Yeah, it's almost like they kind of forgot what self-love is.
Yes. They don't realize that their godliness, their immortality, and their approach does not involve or does not need sacrifice. It comes from within. They want power over others because they feel threatened that when they can't control others, they are less powerful. A true king never treats his subjects that way.
Thank you very much. I'm good.
So disappointed in how some of our kind has done such a thing. So disappointing. We hate to mention such a disappointment, but we will, because we love you. We want you to understand love, because as much as we want to get angry at these people, there are times we cannot do anything to help them, but we use it to help you. Perhaps it's time for us to part. We shall see each other again. When you love yourself like others, you have become a god. Love yourself like you would love others. All right. Well,
thank you, Andy.
Oh, my God.